Good morning, everyone. Please stand and join us in singing Blessed Be Your Name.
Welcome to church this morning. My name's Hannah and I'm one of the ministry staff here. I work with children and families at All Saints. If you're visiting for the first time, we're so glad that you're here. And I just wanted to read quickly from Psalm, I've got it here, 100, where it says, "Give thanks as you enter the gates of his temple. Give praise as you enter its courtyards. Give thanks to him and praise his name. The Lord is good." And isn't it wonderful to walk into church and to be singing together and giving thanks to God? We're going to continue on with the creed. And we're going to sing that beautiful song that speaks of what we believe about God and what we understand about his goodness and faithfulness to us.
Thank you.
Isn't it amazing song to sing those words? You know, sometimes we say them, but we sing them as a declaration of faith. And those words speak of the triumph of Jesus, his resurrection, but it also speaks of the reason he did die, which is that we needed a saviour. And when I'm teaching SRE in schools and when we're talking about why Jesus needed to come and die on the cross, we talk about the word sin, and we explain that it's a little mantra that we have, and it's living life my way, not God's way. And that means it's not about a big list of, oh, did I keep the Ten Commandments this week? But it's about our heart attitude towards our Heavenly Father, our King forever, and our Lord. And you may not know Jesus as your King or your Lord yet. You may be investigating. But in this part of our service and each week, we quieten our hearts and we reflect on when we've been living our lives our own way and not God's way. And so I'd invite you to just take a minute, whether you're older or younger, is to think about when your life has been veering away from God or when you've been living life your own way. We'll think about that for a minute in a quiet, and then we'll pray a prayer together, confessing our need for Jesus. Father, we come before you in worship, yet mindful that we have not always lived the life you've called us to this past week. We have not loved you with our whole hearts, minds, and strength, nor loved our neighbours as ourselves. We pray truthfully and humbly that you will cleanse us and change us. Teach us to love you. Hearts, minds, and lives wide open, obediently, dependently. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen. And in that song, we also heard that we have a Saviour who defeated death, he carried our sin on the cross, and he is faithful and has done the work for our salvation. And I think it's so wonderful that we accept his free gift, and that is the point of grace. So God, we thank you for your gift of grace. Well, the things that we have coming up this week is next Saturday we have a Women's Connect event. We're going to be having a demonstration of making hot cross buns, a chance to connect, but a connect event focusing on that this is a very welcoming event to invite someone to, someone who's new to the area, someone who's exploring or considering a Christian faith or interested in what this is all about. Julie Hayward is the Bishop of Wollongong's wife, who has an amazing story of how she came to faith, and she's going to be sharing that with us. Relatively low-key, lots of time to just hang out and enjoy some of those hot cross buns at the end. So if you'd like to, I think there's a sheet at the back on the table. Hopefully we'll have the square up and running. If not, we will have it up and running on Saturday to pay. There's a $5 cost to cover the speaker's expenses and the cost of just the materials for the day. If you would like some personal prayer after the service, then Sandy will be down the front at the end of the service, and she's happy to pray with you. If anything in the sermon today has made you think, I want to talk more about this with someone, or you've brought something in with you today, a burden or a concern, please do make your way to the front and pray with Sandy. We need to also announce that we have our AGM coming up on the 24th of March. And please consider whether you might be able to serve in the leadership of our church. There are positions in parish council, wardens, synod reps and nominators. So there's some different roles. And there are some nomination forms available at the back of the church. If you're not sure what those roles are, then catch someone, ask someone, who could I talk to find out more about that? And you might find out that one of those people have actually served in those roles and they can explain some of that to you, or they'll be able to point you in the right direction. Also, if you think you'd like to nominate someone else, you just need to check that they're in agreement for being nominated, but you are welcome to nominate someone else with their agreement, and you need someone to second the nomination. And if you do fill in those forms, they can go in the red box at the back. So we have our weekend away coming up soon as well in May. One thing we did want to announce is that we have had someone from our church put their hand up to run a creche program. And so we want to make sure that any children from about 12 months, basically, in that Saturday morning session and the Sunday morning session, there'll be something for them. So we're really hoping that youth and families will be there, that all ages will be able to be there. And if you're not staying, that you find out about coming for the day as well. We do need to sign up. I think there's a sign-up sheet at the back as well, and you can pay a deposit theoretically on the square. We just need to get the password off Jeff. On that note, Jeff is not here today. You may have noticed that he's not up the front. He's not sitting there where he normally is. Jeff is on a family holiday. I think this is their first family holiday with their three children since before the start of 2020. And so they have sent me a photo of the setup. They've got their swag and their little fire pit, and they're just really enjoying having this time to connect with their kids in a deeper way than you can just over a meal, which is normally where they do that. So we're thinking of them and hoping that this is a real time of refreshment for them. And just for anyone who's newish to church, we just want to let you know that we regularly have a Sunday afternoon where you can meet some of the staff and the ministry team and hear a bit about the church structure and beliefs and ask some questions and meet some people from the church in a home setting. And so if you want to save the date, we'll have invitations coming out in the next week or so. So I'm just going to pray for our kids as we head out, and then I'm going to leave you guys to have just a moment to say hello to someone, maybe share about a way that God's blessed you this week, but we're going to head out now for our kids' programs. So Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for our children and our families, the life and the joy that they bring, and I pray that as we go out that you will minister through the leaders to their hearts and minds and grow them in faith and understanding of you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Canish Garafle here. 4 times a year, I hope to share a brief message with the churches. And this year I thought I'd focus on just one verse. Arguably, the best known verse in the Bible, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And today we're starting with this, for God so loved the world. The opening of John's Gospel tells us that the world was made through the Word. And here we learn that God loves the world that he has made. God isn't part of what has been made. He's outside it and above it and beyond it, separate and distinct from the world. But God isn't distant. He's not indifferent or unconcerned with the world. He loves it. This is so ingrained in our culture that we could hardly believe that God could do anything else than love the world. But that wasn't how the ancients viewed it. They had no reason to think that God would love the world at all. And they often thought that there were gods in the world, in the mountains, in the rivers, in the fire and the lightning. The gods were in the world, and the gods were destructive and unpredictable and callous. It'll be Easter before you know it. In a world of tears and trials, sorrows and sins and suffering, God has planted the cross in history as a demonstration and pledge of his love for the world that he has made. I hope you'll have the chance to wonder at the love of God shown in the death and resurrection of Jesus. And I'm praying that we'll have the chance to share that with many others as well. Because we're for Jesus.
Good morning, church. I invite you to bow your heads and pray with me. Almighty God and merciful Father, we worship you for being the author of all things in heaven and on earth. We praise you, Jesus, for being the perfect image and radiance of the Father. And we adore you, Holy Spirit, the giver of life, the comforter and helper. Lord, we give you humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We praise you for sustaining us and for all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your amazing love in redeeming the world by our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, how can we adequately praise you for the gift of your Son? When we could not rise to him, he came down low to be near us and to draw us to himself, giving us grace and the hope of glory. Give us such a sense of all your goodness that we may be truly thankful and may praise you not only with our lips, but in our lives, by serving you in holy and righteous ways. God of nations, all governments rule under your authority. Please give them wisdom. May they fulfill their responsibilities with integrity and work for the good of those they rule, seeking your justice and peace in every law and action. Bring peace, Lord, throughout your creation and banish the spirit that makes for war. Rescue the captives. Shield those in danger, bind up the brokenhearted. For those who are walking in darkness, may the light of your face shine upon them. We especially pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ who've been caught in the crossfire in both Israel and Gaza, Russia and Ukraine. Lord, preserve life and shelter. Above all, we pray that the peoples of Israel, the Middle East, Russia and Ukraine will find everlasting hope in you. Bring peace, Lord, while we wait for Christ's coming and rule, when all people will beat their swords into ploughshares, when nation will not take up sword against nation, and when every tear will be wiped away by the Prince of Peace. Comfort and strengthen those who are gripped by poverty, weakened by illness, or oppressed by cruelty. May they know your love and experience your care. Inspire your church here on earth to love you with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbour as ourselves, displaying your compassion to those in need. Embolden us to proclaim the gospel of your love in the death and resurrection of your Son. May all people hear the call to trust you. Gracious God, we pray for our ministry team and lay leaders, that you would open to them many doors to share the truth found in the Bible, to declare the mystery of Christ clearly, and that the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honoured. We ask for protection from evil and wicked schemes, and that setbacks are used by you for good. Refresh and equip them, Father. May they stay pure, maintain an honourable walk with you, and have the capacity to spend time with the people entrusted to their care. And Father, lastly, we thank you for International Women's Day that was commemorated on Friday. And we thank you for all the incredible women that we know and cherish. We ask that you would bless all women who daily strive to bring peace to their communities, their workplaces, and their homes. Give them strength to continue to sow harmony where there is discord. We pray for all women who face prejudice, inequality, and gender disparities. Grant them justice, Lord. We pray for all women who suffer from the pain of war, violence, and abuse. Save them, Lord. And we pray for all women who live in the despair of poverty, trafficking, and slavery. May the light of Jesus bring them comfort, freedom, and assurance. We ask all our prayers this morning through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honour and glory, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. Our first Bible reading this morning is from Acts chapter 20, verses 17 to 38. That can be found on page 956 in the Bibles that are in under the seat in front of you. So Acts chapter 20, verses 17 to 38. From Miletus, Paul sent to Ephesus for the elders of the church. When they arrived, he said to them, "You know how I lived the whole time I was with you. From the first day I came into the province of Asia, I served the Lord with great humility and with tears and in the midst of severe testing by the plots of my Jewish opponents. You know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. And now, compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. Now, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. Therefore, I declare to you today that I am innocent of the blood of any of you. For I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you, night and day, and with tears. Now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus, the words the Lord Jesus himself said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." When Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. What grieved them most was his statement that they would never see his face again. Then they accompanied him to the ship.
Please stand as we sing our next song, "Nothing But the Blood of Jesus."
The second reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 15, verses 29 through to chapter 16, verse 12. That's Matthew 15, 29 through to 16, verse 12. Jesus left there and went along the Sea of Galilee. And then he went up on a mountainside and sat down. Great crowds came to him, bringing the lame, the blind, the crippled, the mute, and many others. And they laid them at his feet, and he healed them. The people were amazed when they saw the mute speaking, the crippled made well, the lame walking, and the blind seeing. And they praised the God of Israel. Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I have compassion for these people. They have already been with me 3 days and have had nothing to eat. I do not want to send them away hungry, or they may collapse on the way. His disciples answered, Where would we get enough bread in this remote place to feed such a crowd? How many loaves do you have? Jesus asked. 7, they replied, and a few small fish. He told the crowd to sit down on the ground. Then he took the 7 loaves and the fish, and when he had given thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples, and they in turn to the people. They all ate and were satisfied. Afterward, the disciples picked up 7 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was 4,000 men, besides women and children. After Jesus had sent the crowd away, he got into the boat and went away to the vicinity of Magadan. The Pharisees and Sadducees came to Jesus and tested him by asking him to show them a sign from heaven. He replied, When evening comes, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, today it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the sign of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation looks for a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. Jesus then left them and went away. When they went across the lake, the disciples forgot to take bread. Be careful, Jesus said to them. Be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They discussed this among themselves and said, It's because we didn't bring any bread. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked, You of little faith, why are you talking among yourselves about having no bread? Do you still not understand? Don't you remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? How is it you don't understand that I was not talking to you about bread? But be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against yeast used in bread, but against the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. This is the word of the Lord. As you know, Jeff's away, and so he has pre-recorded his message on the video screens. So, without further ado.
Hi, everyone. I'm sorry that this is a pre-record, but we had this weekend away with our kids planned for some time. Well, this is another profound moment on the journey of faith with Jesus. And there's something for everyone. There's something for the crowd, obviously. There's something for the Pharisees, which is very different. There's something for the disciples. And hopefully, there's something for you on your journey of faith with Jesus today. Now, central to this passage that we've just read is the idea of a sign. Now, it's been another big day of miracles with Jesus. But then in verse 1 of chapter 16, the Pharisees demand a sign from Jesus. They're essentially saying, if you're the Messiah, show us your credentials. Show us a sign. Now, be honest. Have you ever asked God for a sign? Yeah, we all have, I'm sure. God, if you're real, show me a sign. God, if this is the way to go, show me a sign. Now, there was a great moment in the history of the Roman Empire, because on the 28th of October, 312 AD, 300 years after the persecution of Christianity as religio illicita, illegal religion, two rival emperors, Maxentius and Constantine, fought a battle on the Milvian Bridge over the Tiber to see who would become the sole emperor of Rome. And on the eve of the battle, Constantine, who was a pagan, claimed to see the sign of the Christian God, a cross in the sky. And so he painted the cross on the shields of his soldiers. True story. He won the victory, he became a Christian, and he proclaimed Christianity the official religion of the empire. It's incredible to think that this dramatic leap in Christianity's story came down to a sign in the sky. Now, the movie Bruce Almighty, yep, some people are nodding, it's getting long in the tooth now, but it is another timeless classic. Jim Carrey, who plays Bruce, has had a very bad day. He's just gotten fired. Let's have a look at this.
Okay, God. You want me to talk to you?
Talk back. Tell me what's going on.
What should I do? Give me a signal.
I need your guidance, Lord. Please send me a sign.
Oh, what's this Joker doing now? Okay. All right. I'll try it your way. All right. Lord, I need a miracle. I'm desperate. I need your help, Lord. Please reach into my life. What the hurry up?
So Bruce demanded a sign, and God, played by Morgan Freeman, literally sends him a truck full of signs. Did you see that? And they're warning that the road is closed. But Bruce is so busy looking for another particular sign that he misses that and he crashes into a pole. Well, right in the middle of our passage, very similar, the Pharisees are asking for a sign, but they're missing Messiah. I wonder if we're holding out for a particular sign and missing Messiah, missing what God has already revealed to us about Jesus. So, three movements: the sign of compassion, the sign of Jonah, and the sign of unbelief. Let's have a look at this. And we're coming back to the beginning here. After a visit to the land of Canaan, aka Lebanon, to see a woman about some faith, Jesus is now heading back down to the Galilee region. And again, he's on the hills teaching and healing the sick. A great crowd, this time 4,000, have gathered around him, and compassionately he's healing their sick. And notice that the people praise God in response. They see the signs and they give God the glory. But the sign they respond to is not just the miraculous and the undeniable evidence of their neighbours who were lame now leaping around. It's fulfilled scripture that Jesus is Isaiah's long-promised Messiah, not some random faith healer. Now have a look at how Matthew's description compares with Isaiah's prophecy in chapter 61. All the same features. It's almost mirror image. And so the people can see that their Savior, Messiah, has arrived almost straight off the pages of Isaiah. But notice Jesus isn't using these people just as his pawns to set up his credibility. He has, in verse 32, real compassion. Genuine compassion. Even their hunger moves his heart. Now, in the last chapter, last week, we saw that Jesus pronounced that he was I am. He was God. And what is the very character of God? It's compassion. Psalm 116. Now, these people have been with Jesus for 3 days. They've been with him for 3 days because they're hungry for their Messiah. They're hungry for the kingdom. They're hungry for every word that comes from Jesus. And yes, they are very physically hungry. And Jesus doesn't walk away from those in need who are hungry for him. Isn't that good news? And so now, it's super picnic day again. This time, as we said, it's 4,000 guests, but it's 7 loaves and 7 baskets left over. And once again, the disciples are thinking, well, how are we going to possibly feed this crowd? It's fascinating how soon they've forgotten the miracle that Jesus did not long ago. I think that can be typical of us. How soon we forget God's mercies and what he has done for us. There is a particular theme that runs through the Bible. It's one word. Remember. Remember what God has done. But you might ask, this is a little bit deja vu, the feeding of the 5,000. Didn't we just have this story? Could this be an editorial oversight? That the writer didn't notice that he's repeating himself and it was too late by the time he'd gone to print. No, because a little bit later in chapter 16, verse 9, Jesus says, don't you remember, disciples, the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and the 7 loaves for the 4,000? No, Jesus is clearly identifying these are 2 separate occasions because Jesus is duplicating this manna in the wilderness miracle to underscore his identity, that he is following in the path of Moses and of Elijah. But he's also very much motivated by compassion. And so he feeds the hungry. And this time, as we said, the number of leftover crust baskets fill 7, not 12 as previous, 7, which is the perfect number of God. So God is putting his stamp well and truly on this miracle. So they get in the boat and they arrive on the western shore of the lake this time, where once again they're met by Pharisees. And ironically, these Pharisees want a sign that Jesus is Messiah. I don't know what it is for these guys, but they keep turning up late for the party and missing the action. They just missed a day of miracles. It's kind of like an APB, you know, in the movies, an all-points bulletin has gone out to all the local Pharisee police stations, watch out for this guy called Jesus. He says he's Messiah. If you see the suspect, ask for proof and hopefully humiliate him along the way. They're asking for a sign, but Jesus is not performing tricks for cynical critics. Jesus is compassionate, but he's not compassionate to cynical hypocrites who demand he prove himself. Messiah is not a circus monkey. He is the one who aligned the planets in the universe. He is the one who set the foundations of the earth. And so he denies them their magic trick. And instead he turns their word, a sign, back on them. And he talks about reading the weather signs, something that everyone understood. So in chapter 16, verse 2, he replied, "When evening comes, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, today, it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you can't interpret the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation looks for a sign, but none will be given except the sign of Jonah." Then Jesus left and went away. He's talking about reading weather signs. Now, I don't know how this works, but shepherds, sailors, surfers, fishermen, and farmers all know this to be true. Red sky at night, sailor's delight. It's going to be fine weather. Red sky in the morning, sailor, take warning. Look, I'm not a weather forecaster or the son of a weather forecaster, but I just know this to be true. And when I'm out bush, I can read the sky. So our Pharisees, even though they're reading the scriptures, they're missing the Messiah. So Jesus' judgment is no Messiah trick. They will only now be given one sign, the sign of Jonah. So this is the second time that Galilean Pharisees have asked for a sign. The first was back in chapter 12. And now again, on these western shores of Galilee, it happens again. And again, Jesus tells them, like in chapter 12, they're only getting the sign of Jonah. And as we said a few weeks ago, in response to the chapter 12 request, Jonah was cast into the sea, and the sea always stood for chaos and death. Jonah was cast into the sea. He was lost to the sea, and then he was swallowed and held in the belly of a great fish. Jonah was written off by everyone. And then, as if resurrected, he was coughed up onto the land of the living. So too, the Son of Man, Jesus, will spend 3 days in the belly of the earth, the grave, the chaos of death. And just as Jonah was coughed up on the land of the living, so they will see death cough up Jesus. Death cannot hold Jesus. And the result will be the vindication of Jesus as the Son of God. The resurrection will make sense of everything. I'm guessing the Pharisees don't really understand this cryptic reference about the sign of Jonah, but they will. Very soon, they will see it for themselves. So Team Jesus leave, and Jesus reflects on the unbelief of the Pharisees, and he warns his disciples against what he calls the yeast of the Pharisees. Now, this is a very serious warning. But the disciples' response is almost comedy, because when Jesus says, "Beware of the yeast of the Pharisees," they think that Jesus has cottoned on to the fact that they forgot to bring the bread on this journey, and they're talking amongst themselves. It's unbelievable, really. They've seen this bread from heaven twice now, but they're still dull. They're still worried about who meant to bring the bread. And so Jesus has to explain, "Guys, I'm speaking figuratively." So what did Jesus mean, figuratively? Well, notice the last time Jesus spoke about yeast, it was in the context of a kingdom parable, just a chapter or two ago, a kingdom parable of the woman who kneads the yeast into the dough. And it moves around the whole dough, expanding and rising. It's a wonderful chemical reaction. This is the nature of the kingdom, which starts small and rises and expands and grows. But now, Jesus is applying the same principle of yeast to unbelief. Unbelief, it seems, works according to the same principle. A deadly yeast that infects the whole loaf, multiplying unbelief, a destructive chemical reaction. And I think it's fair to say that the yeast of the Pharisees has well worked through our culture, spoiling and multiplying unbelief. Don't you think so? The Pharisees' unbelief was characterized by an unwillingness to read the signs that were there. And similarly, unbelief in our culture is not unbelief by rigorous investigation, but of not bothering. Not bothering even to read the Bible, never asking questions, just adopting the unbelief of the others in the group. That's really a social phenomenon known as groupthink or herd mentality. It's when the whole herd move as one, undiscerningly, just doing what the other is doing and thinking, well, the others must know what they're doing, and those others think, well, the others must know what they're doing, and so on and so on. If the herd don't believe, then it's probably safest for the individual in the herd not to believe. And I want to say, don't settle for herd mentality when it comes to Jesus. The guy next to you that you're copying may never have investigated the claims of Jesus. He just got his belief, unbelief, from the guy next to him, who got it from the guy next to him. No one is examining the signs for themselves. That's the great fallacy. I want to say, break out of the herd and check out the signs of Jesus for yourself. You will be surprised. Are Jesus' claims about himself actually plausible? Or do I simply assume they're not because the herd, everybody else, unquestionably accepts that the gospel is a myth? You can see the problem, can't you? Now, Sam Chan, who is the author of Evangelism in a Skeptical World, puts it like this. He explains that we have a plausibility brain wiring, where we often judge whether a story is true or unbelievable, not on the facts, but on whether the others around us believe. A plausibility brain wiring. In other words, if enough people don't believe something, it becomes untrue. Isn't that scary? Because if no one is investigating the truth of something, then it's simply a chemical chain reaction of unbelief. Jesus nailed it. The yeast of the Pharisees. I really hope that makes sense. But the yeast of the Pharisees is herd mentality, group think deception. Whatever you choose to know it by, don't fall for it, especially when it comes to Jesus. There is too much at stake. There is eternity at stake to get this wrong. God has, and we'll close on this, God has given us every sign we need. The sign of a creator God whose fingerprints are all over nature. In Tim Keller's book, The Reason for God, he says it's as if God rolled out a cosmic welcome mat. Because for organic life to exist, the fundamental regularities and constants of physics must have values that fall together in the narrowest of range. That if they were out by just one fraction, it would be impossible for human life to exist. The signs are all over nature. The sign of prophecy in Scripture. The Old Testament has some 2,000 prophecies. prophecies that have come true. And the odds of all those prophecies coming true by chance is less than 1 in 10 to the power of 2,000. That's one chance in 10 with 2,000 zeros after it. There is the sign of the disciples' eyewitness accounts that after the resurrection, they were prepared to die and did for the truth of their testimony. And there is the sign of the gospel itself, the explanation of our own sin as the greatest problem and God's love meeting us at the cross to forgive and reconcile us to him, and the sign of the resurrection, the sign of Jonah. And of course, there is the sign of the transforming power of the Holy Spirit in lives of millions down through history, and God's invitation to you to experience it for yourself. Poor old Bruce Almighty, he didn't really need God to give him a sign. Yeah, sure, it was only a movie. But I want to say that you actually don't need God to give you a sign of your own design. He has given you all the signs you need. In fact, it's a kind of Pharisee move to demand that the God of the universe come down and perform on our little stage something for us so that we'll believe or not. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this rich passage. We thank you for this explanation of signs and the yeast of the Pharisees. We thank you that you are a God of compassion. And the Lord Jesus became compassion on a pair of legs, walking amongst us and healing the sick. We pray that you would have mercy on us on our journey of faith with Jesus, and help us to believe. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand as we sing our last song.
Through the fields of snow. Sunday service. As Jeff said, we are constantly looking for signs, but Jesus is the main sign that God has given us. Go out, enjoy your week, and join us for morning tea.